Hi, it's Tim.
And it's Amy from Go With Less. We're really glad you're here with us today. In this week's video, we're going to talk about our health insurance for 2021. We have been promising this video for months, and it has taken us months to figure out what we're going to do. So there's a lot that we're covering, and I hope you'll watch the whole video.
Every Wednesday here on our channel, we come out with a new video, typically talking about our early retirement or our nomadic lifestyle. In 2015, we left our careers in our late 40s, and in January of 2020, we sold our home and became full-time nomads.
Please subscribe and make sure to hit that like button.
So we're going to do a little housekeeping before we get going here with the conversation. So first thing we're going to say is that we have three children, and none of those children are on our insurance plan. They're all under 26 years of age, but they're all independent and doing their own thing with insurance.
They're adults,
so we don't have them covered. So it's just the two of us when we're talking about insurance.
And also, before we even get into the details, where are we? We are here in Burbank, Los Angeles, California. We are in Johnny Carson Park on Bob Hope Drive, surrounded by Walt Disney Studios, Warner Brothers, Universal Studios, NBC, and ABC. So we are in the heart of Hollywood. It is a beautiful 70 degrees. So such a wonderful situation. We're here in a house sit for a week. And let's get back into health insurance now. Very exciting topic.
Yeah, also we're going to frame up the conversation here. So we're going to start out talking about the options that we had available, and then we'll end with what we actually chose for 2021.
So we can all be on the same page. I'm going to give you a little recap of where we've been. When we retired in 2015, we didn't take COBRA. So in January of 2016, we were on our own for our health insurance. That meant that we were Colorado residents. We were on the ACA or Obamacare for 2016, 2017, 2018, and 2019. And in those 4 years, we had three different providers, different years, because the plans changed so much. So we made a move to Texas in January of 2020, earlier this year, and we decided not to go on the ACA. Now, in this whole time, in June of 2018, we added on Liberty Health Shares along with our ACA plan. So we've had both of those. Now, Liberty Health Shares has been our only insurance for 2020, and we're going to be canceling that in December. And we had a lot of things go into, so that gets you all caught up, but there were a lot of considerations, and we're gonna get talking about what took us so long? What were all these considerations? Why didn't we just stay with Liberty?
Yeah, I guess a little bit more history before we get into all the details here. So the reason that we chose to just have Liberty for 2020 and not sign up for an ACA plan in Texas was because we had intended to leave the country, and we looked at an expat plan, or we were planning to be on an expat plan starting in June, and that all fell apart with our plans falling apart. And so we just had Liberty as our only insurance for this entire year. So now we'll launch into options that we had for 2021. So one option would be to not have insurance at all. For us, we never have considered that an option at all. So here in the United States, if you are in a car accident and you show up at the hospital and you're in the hospital for a month, that could easily be $1 million event. Yeah. And so if we were to have to pay a hospital $1 million for being there for a month, that would put us in a very big bind. And so that's not
We'd have to go back to work.
So that's not something we're willing to sign up for. So I think a lot of people, when they're considering insurance, the first thing that they consider is, well, is my preventative care going to be covered? Am I going to get this $200 doctor bill covered? For us, that's certainly a part of the equation, but it's really a minor part of the equation when it comes to the coverage that we're looking to have. We're looking to have something that's going to cover us when we have a catastrophic event. So again,
not when, if.
If, there you go. If we have a catastrophic event, that's why we're looking for coverage. And so not having insurance, not an option.
Okay, number two is these health ministries. We were on Liberty Health Shares. We hadn't really filed much in the way of claims because we didn't.
I'm going to say not just health ministries now. There's also some secular options. And so they're just called health sharing.
That's
so if you want to look up the options that are available, health sharing.
And for us, we wanted real insurance. So we have had real insurance up until January. We wanted to get back on real insurance. And then Liberty, which we had had some experience with, had increased their premiums from $349 to $499 in like boom. One month it went up 40%, and that was not really acceptable. So a couple weeks, so we had already had this decision of like we were already interested in looking at something else, and then Liberty had a 40% increase, which kind of turned us off to continuing with Liberty. So they have since put out a very high deductible. They don't call it deductible because it's not real insurance, but they had an option that made it more affordable with a $12,000 deductible. And we opted not to do that because we just figured we wanted to do something else. So we're going to get into what it is that we did, but we opted not to stick with Liberty.
Yeah, and we don't necessarily have a problem with health sharing, but there's also some considerations if you're looking at these plans, and that because they're not real health insurance, they're not regulated in the way that traditional insurance is regulated. And so if these providers were ultimately to go out of business or run out of money, then you would be left holding the bag. So again, if we had $1 million experience and we were looking for one of these health sharing places to share that, that could be a problem. And so again, it's just something that we are we're not comfortable with. I'm not saying that we don't do it again in the future, but it's less insurance-y than normal insurance.
Okay, then the next thing that we looked at was expat insurance. And here's the challenge with expat insurance. We were looking at two different providers, IMG Global and Azimuth. And we looked at a whole bunch of them actually, but these were the two that we really kind of finalized on. And this is something that we were so close to doing. Just on a side note, we have been working with the most extraordinary person called, her name is Tracy Winters, at a company that specializes in travel insurance and expat insurance. They're out of Phoenix. They're on Good Neighbor Insurance. I'm going to put their phone number
They're a broker.
Yeah. And they were, so the minute that we're buying expat insurance, we are calling Tracy Winters because she is incredibly knowledgeable. We have nothing to gain from this except she's been so great. We want to send everyone her way because she's amazing. But anyway, the challenge with the expat insurance is, first of all, you have to pick, do you want it to include the United States or not? And both of them were fairly affordable in the realm of affordability with health insurance. But the challenge was, with both plans, we had to be out of the country, number one, for at least 6 months a year. And number two, we had to start that plan within 30 days of signing up for it. With COVID, we don't know where or when or any of that right now. So Tim and I have plans to be out of the country for 10 months a year.
Just a real quick correction. So it's not start the plan. Within 30 days, you had to be out of the country. So you had to leave the country within 30 days. We just got back from Mexico. We drove across the border. They didn't even check our passport when we went into Mexico. So our assumption is that wouldn't have even qualified us for being out of the country.
Yeah.
So this is a challenge for us that we're not comfortable signing up with when we don't know that we can leave.
We were so close. So we were really considering going to Mexico for 6 months. And again, what Tim said, they didn't stamp our passport. They didn't give us any, there's no visa, no nothing where we were in Mexico. And that was in Puerto Peñasco. So we really looked at this as an option, and going deeper into Mexico, we looked at all of that. But just the idea of the uncertainty during COVID, of that we'd have to be out of the country for 6 months, we didn't want to guarantee that, and we didn't want to not be covered if we didn't follow the rules. So that left us really with one option, and that is the option that we took.
Yeah, and we actually think this is going to be a good option because we are going to be in Texas basically for the first 3 months of the year.
Yeah.
And so we have signed up for an ACA plan in Texas, and this plan is only going to cover us in Texas, and so we'll elaborate on that a little bit. But nonetheless, we have signed up for this ACA plan. It's with Blue Cross Blue Shield, and I think it's going to be pretty decent coverage. So one of the nice things, or one of the things we've learned about ACA plans in general, is that they're very different from county to county. There could be differences in what the coverage looks like. So we've heard extremes on both ends of the spectrum. We've heard that in Oregon, for instance, somebody told us a story about, if you have ACA coverage in this one county in Oregon, you only have coverage in that one county. That is it. That is the only place where you have coverage if you sign up for it there. Whereas in Florida, somebody told us a story about, if you have coverage in this specific county, don't know what it is, but you have nationwide coverage as an option for you if you sign up in Florida on an ACA plan in this specific
county.
With a
qualifying plan, with all of that.
That's exactly right. So what we signed up for in Texas is
it's an HMO. We weren't care. So, and I'll talk a little bit about the plan that we had. So when we got on, we are in Polk County, and every county in Texas has different providers. There are only two insurance providers, and between the two of them, they offer, I think, 17 different plans. Now, only one of those plans was an HSA plan, which I didn't mention this, but we had been doing that for the 4 years we were on the ACA. We had an HSA plan. So there was only one of those 17 plans was an HSA plan, and there were only two providers. Now, one provider was a Blue Cross plan, and the other other was some insurance company I've never heard of.
Also, the reason we're interested in an HSA plan is basically just to have money in there for the future. We're not planning to spend that money in the year we actually put the money in, but an HSA is just a great tool to have. And so we have money sort of in the bank for future events, and we've been accumulating that money in an HSA that we have. But if you don't have an HSA qualifying a plan, you can't put any money in the HSA. Sorry.
That's totally fine. So we decided to go with Blue Cross because the other network that we looked at, when we looked at the two sets of doctors, we asked local people for recommendations. We don't know any doctors in Texas to be able to compare the doctor plans. We don't know anybody. So I actually tapped into one of the Choose FI groups, the Choose FI Austin group, to say, hey, who are the doctors that you love? And people really were very, very helpful. They came back with a whole bunch of recommendations of doctors. And then I was able to take those recommendations and compare the two different insurers. And it turns out that Blue Cross had like 80% coverage, where the other one had 0%. So that was kind of a no-brainer to go with the Blue Cross. So now we are on an HMO plan. We have an extremely high deductible. So we have a $12,000 deductible between the two of us. And we are getting a subsidy though, because we are able to control our income.
Our income comes from interest, dividends, and capital gains.
And a teeny bit of YouTube.
That's exactly right. So we have business income obviously from that. And so those aren't enough to push us into any given category. However, in certain years, we can do IRA to Roth IRA conversions that can actually make our income higher or lower depending on what we're looking to do. So we have some ability to modulate our income, I guess, is a way actually some friends of ours suggested. That's a term that sort of makes sense for what we're doing. But nonetheless, that allows us to have access to some subsidies, and so which makes our insurance affordable. We don't know how affordable really until the year wraps up, but we think it's going to be a nice subsidy that we're going to get, maybe even potentially have free coverage for us next year, or subsidized coverage. I shouldn't say it's free. It's subsidized by the government.
And we won't know until we do our taxes for 2021.
That's right.
In reality. Now, this is such a loaded topic. So it is so people ask us a lot of questions about this, but it's depending upon where you live. It depends upon how many people. Are you a single person? Are you a family of six? Exactly. And really just insurance in general. What are your assets? What are your pre-existing conditions? Tim has a major pre-existing condition, which was back surgery he had 3 or 4 years ago. So that's a major consideration. So it's people ask us all kinds of questions, and we're not experts. And so I think we get a lot of, maybe even thumbs downs on these videos, because the topic stings. Health insurance is hard.
Yeah.
Yes, and so we can't give any answers because it is so unique.
Yeah. Something else I wanted to mention, this probably should have been mentioned earlier, but every single coverage that we looked at outside of the ACA, you have to go through underwriting to qualify for the insurance, which means that obviously if you have a pre-existing condition, there's a really good chance that that's going to be excluded. So my back on the Liberty plan was excluded.
Forever.
So if I had an issue with my spine this year while we were on this Liberty plan, I would have to pay for that. So again, if you went to the hospital and it cost me $40,000, I'm out $40,000 if it has anything to do with my spine. So this is something you certainly need to be considering whenever you're looking at insurance that's outside of ACA plans. Or I guess also if you have employer-provided insurance, if you have group insurance, those plans also are going to come with these qualifiers that pre-existing conditions are going to be covered. And so everything else that we're looking at does not provide coverage outside of the ACA for pre-existing conditions.
And we know that a lot of our viewers are working for health insurance. So what a shame that is the reality. But it is. And also, when we get together, not only is it the number one question we have from our viewers and from people who just meet us and are interested in maybe early retirement, but when we get together with other early retirees, with other FIRE people, this is talked about all the time. So it sounds like the most boring, awful thing, but it is such a loaded issue, and everyone is doing it all differently. We're learning from each other. So fortunately, we have a lot of other fun, but we are always talking about health insurance.
I think the reason is the stakes are so high. So it's like, again, if here in our country, in the United States, if you have these events that can cost you $1 million, you want to make sure that you're covered for that.
Yeah. And okay, so here's what I want to know so that we could all learn from each other. If you are watching this video, if you either are early retired or are going to be early retired, please discuss what you are doing, what your plan is down below. Have you changed your plan every single year? Have you been able to keep on the same thing? Are you one of the lucky few who maybe took an early retirement package that included healthcare access until you reach Medicare age? Lucky you, we are jealous beyond belief. So I wanna know all of that down below. If you're in another country, I'd love to hear about how things work in other countries. How is it in your country? Is it just expensive? So if we come to your country without expat insurance and we're just paying out of pocket, are we gonna spend $1 million to be in the hospital for a month with a car accident? I hope not, and that's probably a reason why we'll consider an expat plan when we're finally able to leave the country. So, whew, what else you got, babe?
I think that's it. Thank you so much.
Before
for
you do, hold on. Oh, we're going to tell you, we are on the move tomorrow. Oh, yes, today is just one last thing. I'm sorry. So this is December of 2020, and we are talking about 2021. We have people commenting on our 2018 videos every single day. Things have changed since our 2018 videos. If you're watching this, chances are we've done future videos at the end of like December 2021 for what we're doing next year or when we have our expat insurance. So if you're looking at this years into the future, years past 2021, please check out future videos that we're doing so that it's much more current. And next week, we're going to be coming to you from Scottsdale, Arizona for our Christmas house sit.
Thanks a lot. Adios.
See you soon. We've been promising this video for months, and it has taken us months to research and figure out what we're doing, but we have figured it out, and we're going to share it all with you. I hope you stay tuned for the whole video.
Every Wednesday here on our channel, we come out with a new video, typically talking about our early retirement or our nomadic lifestyle. In 2015, we left our careers in our late 40s, and in January of 2020, we sold our home and became full-time nomads.
That's right. If you are new to our channel, please make sure to hit the subscribe button, give us a like, and let's get into it.